Okay, so once again, good afternoon to each and every one of us. As what we could see, our participants are now starting to come inside our access code. We would like to welcome you all. Let's all together have this momentous event that we have for today as we celebrate your national convention for the year 2020. Now, before we start or before we go to the core of our program, we would like to advise all our participants to please have your microphones muted. Once again, we would like to advise, please, our participants to have your microphones muted in order for us to facilitate a smooth flow for today's convention. Once again, we would like to welcome you all. This is our Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines, formerly ORNAP National Convention for the year 2020. For starters, we would like to place our Almighty in front of this event. However, before we do so, a gentle reminder once again to our participants to please have your microphones muted. Once again, a gentle reminder, please, to our participants to have your microphones muted for us to be able to have a spontaneous flow for today. Alrighty? So on this note, let's place our Almighty in front of this event as we all together start this one out with a prayer to be followed by the singing of our Philippine National Anthem. All together sing our ORNAP hymn.
It's a gift, precious to you and me, given freely from up above. The wellness of life is what we want for us, is what we want to give to those in need. Of call to bring quality care for all those in need. We are perioperative nurses. We are friends and we are partners that join our hands and offer our service for the health of our nation. This is our responsibility. This is our call. Are we ORNAPs?
Yes, we are.
Are we friends?
Yes, we are.
Are we partners?
Wow, yes, indeed. We are perioperative nurses and this is our call. Let's be of service. Now, before we begin with our program proper, as what I could observe, parang medyo mahina ang ating energy for today. And also, let's all together start with this one out with some bang. So, hindi naman tayo makapagpalakpak, ano, but let's just show our spirit fingers. Come on, let's go ahead, give some spirit to our webinar for today. Yes, okay, so let's go ahead and group our participants to our different island groups. So we have our participants from Luzon, our participants from Visayas, and our participants from Mindanao. Now, as I announce your respective island groups, I want our participants from that island group to go ahead and show your spirit fingers. Come on, we could see everyone in our screen. I'm sure hindi magpapatalo ang ating participants sa energy. So let's go ahead and start this one out. We would like to see our participants from Luzon. Come on, where are our participants from Luzon? Show us your spirit fingers. Yes, from Luzon. Come on. Hindi magpapatalo sa energy. I'm sure our participants from Visayas. Where are our participants from Visayas? Woo! Yes, by the way, I am from Visayas too. And we would like to see our participants as well from Mindanao. Mag-ingay, Mindanao. Come on. Where are you? Yes, so as quoted by Shakespeare, life is as tedious as a twice told tale, vexing the dull ear of a drowsy man. Life is, well, neither good nor bad. It is only a place where the good and bad exist and, of course, are in continuous dwelling. Today, my friends, is indeed a celebration of life. The lives of all our perioperative nurses, the lives of all our speakers who are willing to share their knowledge, and of course, the lives of all the people whom we will be serving through our profession. Now, bearing the theme, Impact of COVID-19 Pandemic, a Challenge Among Perioperative Practitioners, ladies and gentlemen, welcome one and all to our Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines, formerly ORNAP National Convention 2020. Now, what better way to start things off than to hear some welcoming words coming from our president. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome President Gabriel Naig.
To our distinguished panelists, guests, Honorable Perla Po, a former Board of Nursing and PRC consultant, esteemed National Past Presidents, fellow board of directors, chapter officers, and past presidents, members of ORNAP. Ladies and gentlemen, a pleasant afternoon to each and everyone. To quote from Florence Nightingale, how very little can be done in the spirit of fear. In this uncertain time, wherein COVID-19 creates fears, risk, and huge impact in the delivery of care to our patients and to us healthcare providers, it is prudent to be equipped with an armor that can protect us, a shield that can transform fears into compassionate care, creates positive impact, and generates excellent care to our patients, fellow healthcare practitioners, and to the community we belong. Indeed, our organization is one for the fight against COVID-19, and this battle can be won by having a proper orientation, training, and education, together with reliable data and evidence-based practice. In addition to this, communication, collaboration, teamwork, management support, and personal empowerment are vital to combat this virus. On behalf of the organization, we would like to extend our sincere gratitude to Dr. Gapus and his team for the IT technical support, expert panelist, moderator, past presidents, fellow board of directors, chapter officers, and members for attending this gathering. Let us learn, relearn, and unlearn from this educational activity. Thank you and have a good day to all.
Yes, everyone, let's show our spirit fingers for President Gabriel Naig. Come on. Yes, thank you so much, President Naig, for formally welcoming everyone. By the way, in line with that, one would also want to highlight the presence of our dear speakers, for without them, then our national convention could not have been made possible. We are very much honored to be graced by Dr. Benjamin Daniel Valera. Hi, Doctor. Good afternoon. We also have in participation Dr. Esther Alinsunurin Sagil. We also have in presence Dr. Ray A. Gapus Jr. and one of our nurses as well, Nurse Roni Montojo Fahilagutan. We're also very much honored to be joined by our past ORNAP National past presidents. Hello, good afternoon. And of course, to our ORNAP chapters and our ORNAP chapter officers as well. All right, so let's all together start this momentous event as we unravel our spontaneous discussion for this afternoon. Before we have our discussions for this afternoon, let's go ahead and set our house rules. By the way, for our house rules, very basic for this one is we would like to advise all our participants to please have your microphones on mute in order for us to facilitate a spontaneous flow for this afternoon. Once again, we would like to advise all our participants to please have your microphones on mute for us to facilitate a spontaneous flow for today. In line with that one, our webinar rules are as follows. Number one is participants other than the speakers should have their microphones on mute. Yes, I cannot emphasize that one more. To please have your microphones on mute to avoid distractions. We would also want to advise our participants to, if you have any questions, it will be entertained at the end of our discussions. We have a flow to be followed. Once again, if you have any questions, your questions will be entertained at the end of the discussions. You may go ahead and raise that one in our chat room. Next, it is also very vital for you to have a stable internet connection to avoid unnecessary disengagements. And finally, would also want to request our participants to please participate and listen actively. As much as possible, would also want to hear what you have to say and what you have to share. We are also very much honored as well to have in presence a former board of nursing. We have Honorable Perla Po. Hi, good afternoon. Welcome to our national convention for this year. Now, ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and unravel our series of panelists and discussants for this afternoon. So without much ado, ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and get to know our first panelist for this afternoon. Our first panelist is a consultant and attending anesthesiologist of the UPPGH Medical Center Asian Hospital Medical Center and St. Luke's Medical Center, Global City. He is likewise the managing partner of the Medical Anesthesia Care and the Clinical Associate Professor of the University of the Philippines College of Medicine, the Vice President for the Board of Trustees, Philippine Board of Anesthesiology, and the current President of the Philippine Society of Anesthesiologists. Ladies and gentlemen, to talk about the topic, Anesthesiologist Perspective, it is with pride and honor that we welcome Dr. Benjamin Daniel Valera.
Hello, good afternoon. Thank you very much for the nice introduction. Can you show my slide, please? Okay. Good afternoon again, once again, to all of you, to the organizers of this webinar. Thank you very much for the invitation. I'm deeply honored to speak in front of you today. Let me start. It's not moving. Okay. Let me start by telling you what anesthesia is all about. It is a branch or specialty of medicine dealing with the following goals: analgesia, keeping that patient in a pain-free state; anxiolysis, to keeping the patient in a calm and managing nervousness; muscle relaxation, we want to prevent muscle contraction and movement, hence promote immobility; and we want the patient to be alive in spite of the artificial sleep the patient is in, homeostasis. But bear in mind that anesthesia is rarely therapeutic nor diagnostic. But it is very important in medicine because it facilitates a lot of diagnostic and therapeutic process. They say that anesthesia is both an art and a science of administering poisons or depressant drugs. There are a variety of routes we can use: intravenous, inhalational, spinal, epidural, nerve blocks, intramuscular, name it, you have it. The effects when we administer anesthesia are systemic. It affects a lot of organ systems of the body, such as the primary central nervous system, your sympathetic nervous system, parasympathetic nervous system, immune, neuromuscular system, respiratory, renal, and you depress a lot of your protective reflexes like swallowing, coughing. In fact, a lot of the patients are more afraid of anesthesia rather than surgery itself. Ergo, we monitor the patient as much as possible and must be able to reverse the effects of the anesthetics before you can safely transfer your patient to an appropriate area, a room, or even send him home. But then one should realize that a lot of the things that anesthesiologists do, like bag mask ventilation, do a laryngoscopy, endotracheal intubation, general anesthesia, use suction secretions, you insert an NGT, are what we call the AGMPs. Or the airway generating medical procedures. Now, we all know that AGMPs are associated with aerosolization of respiratory pathogens such as your SARS-2 COVID virus. Besides, one should also realize that we do a lot of this. The anesthesiologists work very near the patient's airway. Just like the nurses, we are the first to come in and last to go out. So it is really a challenge for us to work at this time of the pandemic, as our work became harder. As anesthesiologists, we continue to do what we do best: provide hypnosis, analgesia, anxiolysis, muscle relaxation, and with the patient in a state of homeostasis. But primum non nocere, it means first and foremost, do no harm. So in this state of pandemic, we must protect the patient very carefully after we deliver the anesthetic. At the same time, with the added goals of: one, you prevent yourself from being infected; number two, prevent yourself from infecting those people around you, your patient, other HCWs, surgeons, nurses, and prevent contaminating your surroundings. So I would like to summarize this slide with the AIM or AIM. Cogito ergo sum, that is according to Descartes. And it means I think, therefore I am. As a citizen of a low-resource country with the incidence of the COVID-19 already exceeding that of China, one should aim to stand for adapt to the situation, innovate, invent if necessary, modify things that you usually do, and maximize the use of your available resources. So what are the things we aim for in this time of pandemic? Now, we do a lot of things differently now. Like for pre-op evaluation, we do a lot of with telemedicine. Our infrastructure inside the operating room, we want to operate in a negative pressure operating room, especially if we do COVID patients. We don and doff your PPEs, which means a headgear, a N95 mask, a head cover, a two layers of gowns, two layers of gloves, shoe covers. And we should emphasize the importance of prompt, proper donning and doffing. The techniques, we have to modify a little. We do a lot of regional anesthesia over general anesthesia, considering all things equal. Now, our induction is a little different. We do bug mass ventilation with a little ventilation as possible, lowering our tidal volumes. And during recovery, we do some things a little differently also. Intubation is better done with video laryngoscopes rather than your direct laryngoscopies. Now, we use a lot of filters, HEPA filters, humidifying filters. We use protective drapes or aerosol boxes when we intubate and we extubate. And when we suction, we use the closed inline suction. So, our role as perioperative practitioners is not only at the operating room, but we also act as policy makers. So, we formulate a lot of guidelines. We formulate workflow, and we do a lot of infographics. As teachers, we seldom do face-to-face interaction right now, but replace this with teleconferencing and maybe team huddles. This is underutilized simulation, but we can use a lot of this before we put our nurses or doctors to the front lines. And we have new trends in teaching using a lot of digital platforms. So that's it. Thank you very much for your attention. Have a good day.
Thank you very much. Once again, that was our first panelist for this afternoon. We had Dr. Benjamin Daniel Valera. Everyone, can we show our spirit fingers for Dr. Valera? Thank you very much, Doctor, for sharing your knowledge to everyone. I'm sure that our participants still have some hanging questions. Please do park that one first. And later during our open forum, we will gladly entertain all your questions. All right? Once again, to our newly arrived participants, we are still having our Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines update for this afternoon, bearing the theme Impact of COVID-19 Pandemic, a Challenge Among Perioperative Practitioners. After having our first speaker for this afternoon, let's go ahead and get to know our second discussant for today. Our second speaker is the President of Shared Endeavor Incorporated, the founding and current President of the Philippine Surgical Infection Society, Chairperson for the Committee on Surgical Infections, Philippine College of Surgeons, the co-chair for eHOPE Committee of the Philippine General Hospital, a member of the Fee House Oversight Committee, UP Manila, at the same time a faculty advisor for Phi Lambda Delta Sorority, the chairman of the Department of Outpatient Services, PGH, the training officer of the Division of Pediatric Surgery, PGH, a medical specialist too of the Department of Surgery, Pasay City General Hospital, and at the same time, the attending pediatric surgeon of the Department of Surgery, Philippine General Hospital, an associate professor for of the Department of Surgery, UP College of Medicine. Ladies and gentlemen, to talk about the topic, the surgeon's perspective, let's all together welcome Dr. Esther Alinsunurin Sagil.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon, Doc.
Congratulations to the ORNAP for holding their first ever online congress. Ibang klase talaga tayo, no? Hindi pwede papatigil, ano? Kailangan, go lang ng go. Hindi pwede papatahimikin tayo. I noticed that those who are commenting on the chat box are from all over the Philippines. So congratulations. Alam natin na meron sa atin ng mga medyo in ECQ mode at meron naman sa atin na medyo mas relax sa mode. So, swerte nyo kung nando kayo sa mga relax na mode. But for those in the ECQ mode, ingat-ingat lang tayo. I can see people who are there in their workplaces. So, ingat kayo ha. Do not touch anything dirty. For those in quarantine, pahinga lang muna kayo dahil in the next 2 weeks, so pasok ulit kayo. Okay? So, I was tasked to talk about the surgeon's perspective regarding what's happening in this COVID pandemic. There are really a lot of challenges and issues, and I think malaking problem ng lahat is, ano ba talaga kuya? Iba-iba ang patakaran ng mga ospital, pati ang DOH, paiba-iba ang reporting ng data, and I think it's creating some confusion. May evidence naman eh, we're all aware about the evidence, but it's really the interpretation of the evidence and the personal biases or institutional biases. We know that there's a lot of fear going around, and I can't blame them, particularly if you've been one who was close to somebody who died from the COVID pandemic or has taken care of relatives. So it's important that hindi naman ano, pero importante ang self-preservation because walang makakapagpatuloy ng trabaho natin kung hindi natin i-preserve sarili natin. So may have the next slide, please. What do we know at this time? We know a lot more now than we did last February, but definitely hindi siya ang last. What we know is, initially we were told So we know that the mode of transmission is by droplet, although in the last month, we were also told that there seems to be more evidence now that airborne transmission is also possible, particularly when you do aerosol-generating procedures or what are known as the AGPs. We also know that in spite of all the fear, actually 90% of the patients who get infected with COVID are actually just asymptomatics or milds, and there is a 1 to 2% mortality rate. Currently, we're in the 93,000 and our mortality rate is 2,000, so that's closer to 2%. The pneumonia that arises from COVID is little prolonged. It's not a one-week disease. We see patients who get admitted for 3 weeks or even 4 weeks. And unfortunately, there's no cure. Many vaccines are in various stages of development. At the start of the pandemic, there was only RITM and San Lazaro. But now we have more than 32 laboratories doing the tests, but they're not enough. And the test results, which Bill Gates said should be available in 48 hours to be of significance, or to be relevant, sometimes comes out long after you've already recovered, which means the contact tracing is going to be useless. Okay, so we need laboratories, we need the tests when and the results when they should be in, and that should be within 48 hours. And for us in surgery, in the Global Surgical Collaborative Study in the UK, they found out that 50% of COVID patients who went through surgery had complications, and mostly they were of the pulmonary kind. Next. So this is that study, which came out last May. The study was done in May, but this article came out in June. They said that 50% had pulmonary complications, of which there was a 38% 30-day mortality. Okay, that is not nice. And mortalities happened even if the patient was underwent only elective surgery. So it was this landmark study that told everybody that, oh my goodness, even if I'm asymptomatic, but I am COVID positive, if I undergo elective surgery, there's still a chance that I would die. Okay, next please. So I would just like to give you some information about the role of RT-PCR or what's commonly known as swabbing in surgery. For the healthcare workers, we want to know if the patient is infective so that we can prepare accordingly. Okay, we need to know how much preparation can we do. Can we be in level 2 PPEs or do we have to go all the way? Why is it important? PPE level 4s are not comfortable at all for those of you who've had the need to wear them. And they're also not cheap. So again, in an institution, in a country with this low resource, we need to be able to tell everybody, look, we don't have to make it that expensive, as long as we know that this patient is not infected. For the patients naman, we need kasi to tell them what their risks are, because that is going to be their question now. Several patients who were brought to my clinic, that was the main question of the relatives. Hindi yung kailangan ba talagang gawin yung operation. They know that the patient needs a surgery. But rather, what is the risk that my baby or my patient will succumb to COVID? So can I wait this out? And if we're going to wait this out, how long should we wait? And that is still an unknown. The complications, potential complications are higher. I've already seen patients who tested negative and underwent surgery within 2 days after the results came out. And still on the fourth day developed severe pneumonia and succumbed from that. So it was an eye-opener for us. Possibility of even developing nosocomial COVID infection, because we are healthcare workers, we may be the repositories of the COVID virus, is also possible, and we could be in the presymptomatic stage. Other concerns are, of course, the cost of hospitalization. For those who don't know, just for a simple appendicitis, the cost of additional cost of PPEs for surgery, if you do it as a COVID suspect, is somewhere in the range of 60 to 100,000 pesos. So that is a big eye dilator, pupillary dilator for relatives when they realize that. And of course, we need to know the risk to our patients and staff. Next. So this is a very nice graph, which I don't need, should not explain anymore. But this came from JAMA, or the Journal of American Medical Association. Just suffice it to say that if you do the test, the RT-PCR test, immediately after being exposed, it's useless. You should do the test after the day one up to day three of symptom onset. Next, please. And this slide tells you when a coronavirus carrier can be infective. So the blue curve is this pre-symptomatic stage. Pre-symptomatic means patient is already infected, person is already infected. 45% of infections come from pre-symptomatic people. The green curve is symptomatic patients or symptomatic carriers. 40% of infections come from this type of coronavirus carrier. Only about 5% comes from the environment. I'm sorry, 10% comes from the environment and 5% of infections come from asymptomatic. So that's why there has to be some distinction between being asymptomatic, which is no symptoms at all, to being presymptomatic, which means you're going to develop symptoms in a few more days. Next, please. Next. So this is a very nice Facebook post coming from, coming from Dr. Salvano, is one of our infectious disease specialist and who likes to put out Facebook posts just for layman's terms. So it's a very nice table because it tells you all the information you need. Go to the fourth column. Between day one to date of infection, your RT-PCR is going to be negative. But even if you're already symptomatic, which is sometime the day five to day eight, there will never be a 100% positive RT-PCR test. The highest it can go is 80%. What does that tell you? If you are symptomatic and you have an RT-PCR negative, I will not believe the test. particularly if you're a healthcare working in COVID conditions, or you have a relative, you live with a relative with COVID, then there's still a very big possibility that you are still suffering from a COVID infection. That is why in the WHO classification, a suspect is one who has symptoms, a probable had tests, but tested negative, or if the test was not a reliable test, or if they got a bad sample. Okay? So this is very important because many people feel that they're already safe if they see a negative test. Don't feel safe. Don't. Because it is never a 100% specific test. It is a sensitive test. Sensitive means if it shows positive, yes, that is a positive test. But remember, we are now getting people who are positive in the third week, fourth week of illness, in which case they say it's just the RNA particles, non-infective anymore. But still, that is the point, that it is still a positive test. Okay? And after day 16, day 21, it's very unlikely that your RT-PCR will be positive, and then your antibodies start going up. So we do not use antibody tests. So look just above the table, just above the yellow line, a negative test cannot rule out COVID-19. That should be a caveat for everyone. Next. So what should we consider? You should think of the patient as a surgeon, hi? Does your patient live with a COVID-positive patient? Meron ba siyang kamag-anak na kaka-discharge lang and that he lives with that patient? Or does the patient live in a COVID hotspot? It's very easy to find COVID hotspots. If you listen to the news, you will see where there are lockdowns every day for 2 weeks. Or if you look at the WHO or DOH tracker, there it was in red. What kind of surgery is to be performed? Dr. Valera alluded earlier about aerosol-generating procedures. Those surgeries that take place around the area digestive tract, around the mouth, those that under patients who undergo endoscopy, we now see evidence that even in the feces, coronavirus can be excreted. So that's why you don't see too many endoscopies nowadays. And if the patient has been symptomatic in the last 2 weeks. Because these are the factors that will tell you you might be at risk if you do surgery at this time. Next. So this was a graph that came out from the University of Kansas last March. And it stratified the type of PPE that you would ask for, that you would wear. Just take note about the, look at the surgical procedures under local and regional anesthesia. And here in this graph, they put an X under goggles, face mask, and PAPR. We strongly disagreed with this. With the rest, we agreed. If you're just somebody in the clinic, you can just wear gloves and probably a face shield. And so next, please. So the Philippines, we modified this. This now takes into consideration the recommendations of the PSMID, our Philippine Society for Microbiological Infectious Diseases, and the Philippine College of Surgeons. So here, after surgery under local anesthesia, we put face shields and goggles and gowns aside from gloves. So that's the only modification we placed. But again, look, everybody, we ask, now, if you're going to do any surgeries, please wear face shields and goggles. So, because we see now, even in my own institution, we see that if the patient tests negative, they'll just wear the usual surgical mask, how we used to do it pre-COVID. But now that we know that COVID is around and we know that RT-PCR is not a foolproof test, we should protect ourselves accordingly. So, pagsanayan nyo na, kahit medyo nakakahilo, pagsanayan na ang mag-goggles at saka mag-face shields. And double gloves. Next, please. So what other modifications do we need to make in the OR? I think Dr. Valera talked about the negative pressure. Next. Negative pressure environment. There are, of course, in the JCI hospitals, the big time hospitals, and they already have negative pressure environments. They have negative pressure ORs. These are not new things. Matagal na naman to eh. Airborne infections like tuberculosis, pneumonia, measles, they should be done in the negative pressure environment. But unfortunately, because it's rather expensive also to create these environments, hindi masyadong nabigyan ng prioridad. But now that COVID came and everybody felt the need, bigla naglabasa, no, there are equipment, there are built-in equipment for negative pressure. There are machines that can create negative pressures. Pero kung medyo wala kayo ng low-resource environment, even putting exhaust fans can help, you know, in creating a negative pressure environment. The use of HEPA filters or ULPA filters, again, HEPA filters, high efficiency particular filters have been available for the longest time. They've practically filtered out all viruses and germs, but there is such a thing as an ultra light, an ultra low particulate filter, that's ULPA. So meron pa siyang 5 sa dulo. So mas mataas pa, mas maliliit yung mga butas niya. We used to use this in our TCVS ORs, in our transplant operating rooms, but now there's a clamor to put this even in our regular operating rooms. There are now operating rooms that do UV sterilization after each operation, but the clamor actually is just to do a thorough terminal disinfection after each surgery. So hindi na ngayon cursory lang. And then, if possible, use disposable supplies and equipment. Bawal na yung sharing, may tira-tira. Ginagamit sa susunod na operasyon. No? And then, if you really need to use, syempre, kailangan mo reuse ang iyong mga gamit na mga instruments, you have to do careful sterilization, cleaning, disinfection, sterilization after each of these operations. We also have to get used to using PAPRs and barriers, particularly at the side of anesthesiologists. And then, one of the new new normals is doing post-anesthetic care in the OR where the COVID patient underwent the surgery, because you don't want to contaminate your PACU, which has patients who are non-COVID. Next. So just some words about surgical smoke inhalation. Again, these are not new things. Ever since, the smoke that comes out of the cautery, whether in derma clinics, no, endoscopy suites, or ORs, have always been determined to emit toxic substances, toxic fumes from the surgical plume. So more than 150 hazardous chemicals have already been identified. But we now found out that even the coronavirus can be emitted or can escape through the surgical plume. And remember, even in abdominal surgery, we have seen coronavirus even in the peritoneal cavity. So, medyo na-shock din kami na pwede pala yun, ano? So now, mas mataas ang kamalayan, mas kailangan natin maintindihan na we have to evacuate the smoke, no, before it reaches everybody. Okay, next. So this is just an example of the surgical machine. So it looks like one of those contraptions here. It just looks like a cautery machine. But look at the middle picture. These are all proprietary. Big sabihin, may brand to lahat. So lahat yan may presyo. But you know, it's easy to improvise. What I do is, I just put this in ibang cautery pen. Pinagdidikit ko lang sila ng suction tubing. So nakalabas lang yung dulo ng cautery pen doon sa suction tubing. Para tuloy-tuloy, and syempre naka-on na suction, ha? Okay. And then tuloy-tuloy ka lang, habang nagkukotery ka, agad nang sinasuction yung smoke ng habang nagkukotery ka. So this makes it very efficient and lessens your exposure to potential COVID smoke. Next, please. So what's our new normal? Definitely, we're not doing things as we used to do them. And it's creating some form of uncertainty and fear. And I think everybody knows, ang laki na ibinaba ng census natin, ano? Una, dahil maraming ang hindi nagpapa-opera ngayon ng elective. But even patients in emergency conditions are delaying their consultations such that the morbidity now and the complications are much higher. We estimate na, and parang mas mataas pa yung mortalities natin from non-COVID cases that do not get healthcare, the proper healthcare compared to the deaths in COVID. Next. So efficiency is key. Our infographics as early as 2016 always say that limit the number of people in the operating room. Now it's mas claro, only essential personnel should be in the OR. So from the start, during the planning stage, during the huddle, tell everybody now what is your role in this operation and do you have to be inside? Because we all don't want to be contaminated, to be infected. So, kung sino lang yung kailangan. Number two, your equipment supply should be prepared well in advance. I think most, since you're all perioperative nurses, you know what supplies will be needed. And it's important to have good communication with your surgeons as to be able to prepare the requisite equipment and supplies. And ideally, they should all be within the OR para hindi nalabas-masok. No? And any unused supplies, unused vials of unused medicines in vials should be disposed of. The cleaning and disinfection of the rooms after each case is a difficult Herculean task, but this should be done meticulously if we want to keep every patient safe. And of course, staff safety and training is of paramount importance. I know it's also a concern now that nurses are being rotated from the OR down to the wards, down to the ER. And sometimes we all know that OR is a specialty area. And to put somebody who has been in the clinics for the longest time and suddenly is thrust into the OR, you know, you're bound to make mistakes if you're not properly trained for it. So it's very important that training is there. Next. So we now know that the total OR time is going to be significantly increased because we do need to prepare a lot. We do things now more deliberately. No? I was even told that during intubation, di ba, pag nag-intubate, yung anesthesiologist na nandun, yung kanyang assist, everybody else go out. And then we are told na the good time, waiting time is 10 minutes before you go in so that the dust has all settled. With the current way that we do things, the manpower requirements and the resource requirements will be much higher. And what does this mean? It's going to be more expensive. We have a lot of disposables now. So we also are creating a lot of trash, by the way. And as far as manpower requirements are concerned, if you have to do quarantine of your staff every now and then, you might end up with a hospital that has less than half of its normal manpower and really creates a strain on everybody. And number three, the communication is not going to be easy. For those of you who have participated in surgeries where you're in N95 masks or elastomeric respirators or even PAPRs, everybody's ngongo, no? So everybody's got a hollow sound and you have to speak louder. You don't want to speak too long because when you're wearing an N95 mask, you end up gasping for breath because of the CO2. So I've also taught my nurses, our OR nurses, to do some hand signs so that you don't have to waste your energy or use a lot of energy just trying to communicate what you need. That is why preparation is key in the ORs that we have to do. Next, please. Okay. Just a word about donning and doffing. We never used to talk about this, but dress on and dress off. We all know that donning, we should have a safety officer to take a look at if you're doing the donning and doffing properly. But if you're going to worry about anything, worry about the doffing. Between the two, it's actually the doffing that is more crucial because you can get contamination during the doffing. Okay? So it's just adhering to the proper techniques and try to mean what we did, and it's easy, it made it easy, is putting in signs around a room. Ano yung task na nandun? So first, do your hand hygiene. So nandun yung task para everybody gets reminded, para you don't make any mistakes in the donning and doffing. And then reminder to practice the hand hygiene in between steps and to use the allow the hand drop solution to dry before putting on gloves. Because I see now people who have rashes and excoriations on their hands because of some reaction to the alcohol rubs. Next. I think that is the last slide, so I just leave you with this quote that yesterday is history, a lot has happened. Tomorrow, we don't know what is going to happen, but today, it's a gift from God. We should live it and learn from it, and that's why we call it the present. So thank you for listening.
Yes, there you have our second panelist for this afternoon. Everyone, let's show our spirit fingers for Dr. Sagil. Yay, there you go. Thank you very much, Doctora, for sharing using your knowledge and expertise, I'm pretty sure that all our participants were able to relate in terms of the practice, in terms of the challenges, and of course, in terms of the challenge and the change that we'll be facing as we go ahead with our practice during COVID-19 pandemic. Once again, to our newly arrived participants, we would like to welcome you all once again. We are still currently having the Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines Continuing Education Program. So for everyone's guidance, our topics for this afternoon are revolved on the impact of COVID-19 pandemic, a challenge among perioperative practitioners. After listening to our second speaker for this afternoon, let's go ahead and get to know our third panelist. By the way, a gentle reminder once again to our participants to please have your microphones on mute to avoid unnecessary sounds as our speakers are discussing. Furthermore, if you have any questions to be raised, please feel free to go ahead and type it on our chat box and we'll gladly read it for you during our open forum, okay? On this queue, ladies and gentlemen, let's go ahead and proceed with our third speaker for today. Our third speaker is a subject during the 25th edition of a marquee Who's Who in the World in the year 2008. The first Filipino nurse entrepreneur to represent the Philippines in the 2005 Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the World Summit. A keynote speaker for the 2010 Mosby Elsevier ASEAN Publications Conference in Singapore and speaker in various international forums in the United States, Ireland, India, Singapore, and China, Dubai, Malaysia, Brunei, and Hong Kong, and of course, the Philippines. The winner of the 2010 International Book Awards, the first Filipino author to write publications for the world's number one healthcare publisher, Mosby Elsevier. The first Filipino nurse entrepreneur to be awarded the 2004 Agora Award for Entrepreneurship, a cum laude for his BSN at the University of Santo Tomas. The board top-notcher for the June 1992 Philippine licensure exam. A summa cum laude for his master's degree in nursing and at the same time a university scholar for his doctorate in nursing at the UP Manila. He is also a recipient of two doctorate degrees honoris causa from the Ramon Magsaysay University, Doctor in Entrepreneurial Management, and Pangasinan State University, Doctor in Science. To talk about the topic, PPE, Pandemic Personal Empowerment Strategies, ladies and gentlemen, an international author, a researcher, a lecturer, and an entrepreneur, we have Dr. Ray A. Gapus Jr.
Thank you very much for the very comprehensive introduction. It seemed to be longer than my talk. At any rate, after our fellow panelists have discussed about the impact of COVID in terms of us healthcare workers, as well as in terms of our working environment. At this point in time, I'd like to highlight what my talk will be all about. So it's gonna be focusing on ourselves as healthcare workers, as nurses. And if I'm going to tell you, I'm sure everyone would agree with me if I tell you that at this point in time, the pandemic is really putting a toll on us nurses. So it has caused us so much stress such that it has put a strain in terms of one's married life, one's financial life, our family life. So at this point in time, I'd like everyone to answer and direct ourselves to the question, how do we empower ourselves to enable us to withstand this multifaceted crisis? It's really overwhelming. So let me share with you some strategies and let me begin by asking all of you colleagues to please do raise your right hand. Right hand, everyone. Okay. Place it on your chest, middle part of our chest. I'd like to highlight the fact that at this point in time, when everyone seems to be focused on maintaining their mental health, their physical health, sometimes it's difficult to extract support from the people around us, and we're left with no one but ourselves. But there's one organ in our body that is capable of reassuring us at this most vulnerable time of our lives, and that's our heart. So I'd like everyone at this point to listen to our heart sounds, because the first heart sound, love, represents the most powerful emotion that we need at this time, and that is love. The second heart sound, which is dove, represents dove, the bird that symbolizes peace. So if we want to feel love during this time and at peace with ourselves in our workplace, all you have to do is to feel your heartbeat and listen to your heart. So as you do this now, I'd like you to feel your heartbeat and close your eyes and listen to this. As you close your eyes, I'd like you to focus on what you are hearing. I'd like you to focus on what your heart is trying to tell you. And now, just listen to this. At these trying times, when it is not easy to keep one's faith, when what you can hold on to is just your desire to serve, just listen to your heart. Continue to believe that all these too shall pass. Just don't quit.
Dark is the night.
Dark as the night may seem,
weather the storm.
Believe that you can do this.
Never say die.
Never say die.
I've been down this road before.
Remember,
I'll never quit.
You are doing this for yourself, your family, and for your patients. Believe that you can survive the storm, that eventually you can outdo the norm. And say to yourself, give up, never give in, never let the rain without sleeping. And if I fall, I'll never fail, I'll just get up and try again. Never lose hope, never lose faith, there's just too much at stake. Upon myself I must depend. I'm not looking for place or show. I'm gonna win.
Don't stop now.
You are here to win. Keep moving. And remember, even in times like this, never quit. Believe that you can. Believe in your strength. And as you continue to fight, always say this to yourself. Just this.
Never give up. Never give in. Never let the rain without sleeping. And if I fall, I'll never fail. I'll just get up and try again. Never lose hope, never lose faith. There's just too much at stake. Upon myself I must depend. I'm not looking for place or show. I'm gonna win.
And as you continue to serve, as you continue to pursue your mission to preserve life, always remember to listen to your heart. Be at peace with your heart. Feel the love. And just don't forget. Remind yourself just this. Only this.
Never give up. Never give in. Never let the rain that's sleeping. And if I fall, I'll never fail. I'll just get up and try again. Never lose hope, never lose faith. There's just too much at stake. Upon myself I must depend. I'm not looking for plays or show. I'm gonna win.
And as you open your eyes, say to yourself, I have the power to win. I believe I will win.
So once again, at this point in time where a lot of things is actually interfering with our abilities to function at our best in terms of our work environment, let me share with you an important fact that you could probably take with you. Because a lot of us right now are so stressed. There's actually a study that says people who experience a lot of stress have 43% increased risk of dying. But there's a big but. If they believe that stress is harmful to their health. So if we just consider stress as a friend, if we look at it as a positive thing, then we would more likely benefit from getting stressed almost every day of our lives. Now, in that study done in Harvard University, there are two things that were considered as highlights. One is looking at stress as a form of challenge, and the second is looking at stress as a threat. In both perspectives, or the way how we look at stress, our sympathoadrenal medullary response is activated. However, the big difference is, if you look at stress as a challenge that you can overcome, yes, your heart will pump harder to supply oxygen and blood to the rest of the body, but in response, the blood vessels dilate, thereby decreasing blood pressure and promoting calmness and relaxation. That is if you see stress as a challenge that you can overcome. But if you look at stress as a threat, the heart still pumps harder, but this time the reverse happens with our blood vessels. The blood vessels constrict, thereby increasing the blood pressure, increasing now our potential for cardiovascular disease as well as stroke. And who needs those conditions at this point in time? So to comply with the 5-minute opening statement that we were asked to prepare for this convention, I'd like to share with you the pandemic personal empowerment strategies, and there are 5, okay? This includes power of self-awareness, overcoming stress and preventing burnout, working for today, extracting support, and recharging. Look how these 5 strategies form the word power. So I actually pre-recorded my talk such that there are steps that I'd like you to learn how to do this on a day-to-day basis, and we'll provide you with the link because I am told that we are given 5 minutes to give an opening statement, but I'll be glad to answer questions that you have during the Q&A portion. So with that, so thank you very much, colleagues, and I'd be glad to answer your questions in the Q&A portion, and I'd be giving you a link to the pre-recorded talk I prepared so that I don't go beyond the time limit that is provided to me. Thank you very much.
All right, there you have him. Thank you very much to our third panelist for this afternoon. Everyone, let's show our spirit fingers for Dr. Ray Gapos Jr. Come on. Yes, good job, Dr. Ray. Thank you very much for inspiring everyone. We know that that is what everyone needs right now, some inspiration. And of course, something to hold on to for us to be able to continue with our craft and our profession as perioperative nurses. On this note, fellow colleagues, once again, we are still having our Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines continuing education program bearing the theme, or the title rather, Impact of COVID-19 Pandemic, a Challenge Among Perioperative Practitioners. We already heard our three panelists for today, and without further ado, let's welcome our fourth speaker that we have. Our fourth speaker is a Nurse for Program Coordinator, Division of Nursing Education and Training at the UPPGH, a head nurse for 9 years at the SOJR Operating Room Complex, Philippine General Hospital, a certified sterile processing specialist by the German Society for Sterile Supply, a basic life support trainer, and at the same time, a certified intravenous therapy preceptor. Some of these awards include a Service Award in the PGH Year 2018, Gawad Chancellor Awardee from UP Manila 2013, and the Award of Excellence in Perioperative Nursing, the Consuelo Gomez Award from ORNAP in the year 2009. Ladies and gentlemen, nurses, to talk about the topic, OR Nurse Manager's Perspective, let's welcome Nurse Roni Montoho Fahilagutan.
Good afternoon, colleagues, and I would like to thank the organizer of this convention for allowing me to be part of this webinar. Actually, I am speaking in behalf of the chief nurse of the operating room, nurse operating room here in PGH, which is the past president also of ORNAP. She is Ma'am Julie Mangahis. And allow me to share with you our experience, our story in dealing with this pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic. We all know that on March 23, 2020, the Philippine General Hospital was designated as one of the COVID-19 referral hospital for the National Capital Region. And during that time, our director, Dr. Gerardo Legazpi, has organized a crisis management team that are composed of doctors, nurses, dietitians, among others, to look into or to man the following committees: logistics, housing and accommodation, transportation, infection control, human resource management. And initially, there were three teams who take turns in reporting to different wards, both for COVID and non-COVID wards. And during the first phase of this ECQ, all of us have enjoyed 7 days and 14 days off. Then it was reduced a month later by 5 days duty and 10 days off. And upon the transition to GCQ and the resumption of other services in the hospital, our duty is already reduced to 7 days off and 7 days duty and 7 days off. And for the offices and the non-COVID wards, do the regular schedule of duty. And during the start of the ECQ, the PGH has committed 130 beds initially that are being distributed to the following clinical COVID areas. Like the service wards, we have the wards 1, 2, 3, and 4. And in the DPPS, or the Department of Patient Services, we have designated the 5th RCB and the 6th RCB ward, and the Department of Emergency Medicine, OBAS, or the Obstetric Admitting Section, and the Pedia COVID. And our ICUs are, we utilize the surgical ICU, the medical ICU, and the central ICU. And in the operating room, we allocate the left central block gynae OR for the COVID ward. So they assign three rooms in the LCB OR. And on the resumption of the GCQ, the hospital opened other services such as both adult surgical and medical wards. And the operating room as well has already resumed performing elective surgeries beginning on June, early on June, and for the service patients. And for the pay patients, we started early on July. And among the best practices that our institution, especially particularly the nursing services or the perioperative nursing, in dealing with this pandemic is, number one, being proactive to have proactive support to the management directives and initiatives. Like we set up the OR, we cover the equipment with cling wraps, and with this we create the structural zone. We identify the zone of the COVID area. Then we have the green zone, the orange zone, the red zone. The green zone is the cleanest area. Orange zone is a transition between the green zone and the red zone, which is if this is a contaminated area, the orange zone. And the red zone is the operating room per se. And another is we ensure that there is an adequate PPE for every healthcare worker. And of course, reassignment of staff to the different COVID areas, no? Because our elective cases during the start of the ECQ has been halted. So we send some OR nurses to the different COVID wards, no? It takes by turn, no? Hindi lang sila. Scheduled yung mga staff na pinapadala namin sa COVID area. So we also designated safety officers. These are nurses, doctors, nursing attendants, and sometimes ward assistants to ensure meticulous enforcement of correct donning and doffing procedures. And also to ensure the safety officer should ensure infection control guidelines are strictly followed during the procedures. No? And usually, as I have said, these are doctors, nurses, and most of the times these are head nurses or the charge nurses who are in charge to be a safety officer. And being proactive in our institution, the PGH Dietary Department also ensures of equal distribution of food, not only for our food that are coming from the dietary department, but those foods that are donated for us. So it has to be equally distributed among the healthcare workers. And number two, initiative that we have in our institution is the nursing personnel should work as a team. Initially, there were three teams, no? Sabi kong kanina, the team A, B, and C. Now there are only two teams, the A and B. And the reassignment of nurses from COVID to non-COVID to COVID wards. And also, you know, on our part, the Division of Nursing Education and Training, we work closely with the HICU and the HICU in orienting to the infection control guidelines to our nursing personnel, specifically for COVID-19. And we are in charge for demonstration of the correct donning and doffing procedures of PPEs. And we also brief and debrief all nursing personnel prior to assignment, no? Prior to and after assignment to COVID wards. This were being facilitated by the PGH Care Society or the Counseling and Assistance Towards Recovery and Empowerment. I will discuss that later. So another strategy we have is managing the transmission and translation of information from the top management down to the staff level. So as we are prohibiting from a large gathering, nurses are utilizing various platforms of communication such as Zoom, Messenger, Viber, and many others. So the OR also conducts huddles prior to surgery. This includes the whole surgical team, no? To discuss the pre, the intra, and the post op needs of the patient. And it is also in the huddle where the role of each member is being reviewed. And in dealing with the staff, the seniors or the head nurses, the managers, should utilize more personal approach in talking with their staff. They should call the staff by name, using kind words to show appreciation like kumusta ka, thank you, ingat kayo, stay safe. And this is very much appreciated by the staff, especially when they are all tired and they are all sweating from the PPE that they just worn. And we cannot avoid also that there are some people who do not want to be assigned in the COVID areas. And they will say that they have certain comorbidities. But as a leader, we must have to be firm in every decision that we are making, especially when we encounter individuals such as this. Another strategy is like what I have said, that the nursing department or the nursing services has created the PGH Care Society, the counseling and assistance towards recovery and empowerment. And this is a very, very significant during this time, no? Because this society is composed or a group of trained nurses who are in charge in briefing and debriefing and giving psychosocial processing session in the management of anxiety before and after working in the COVID areas. They also do peer counseling, one-on-one session, and sometimes they do online. And maybe this the nurses in the PGH Care Society work 24/7. So when the nurse feels that she needs somebody to talk, they can call the members of the PGH Care Society any time of the day to have them to talk. And they also conduct mindfulness and art therapy. And they also have this care pool. They are providing actually transportation assistance to those nurses or nursing personnel who are living in a far or a nearby provinces such as Cavite, Laguna, and Bulacan. So they provide that carpool. And then they also do distribution of self-care kits. And they do online mental health campaigns to boost the morale and to enhance coping and promote positivity. And they regularly post encouragement and positive notes to sustain psychosocial support to the staff. And they also join the medical social service when patient is being discharged. I know that this pandemic has really brought a lot of alteration in our life as a perioperative nurse, both in our personal and professional aspect. The mere fact that our management, our superiors, our managers show support and care for us is just enough to boost our morale and continue to battle in this crisis. Thank you.
Wow, there you have him, our fourth speaker for today, speaking in behalf of our OR nurse manager's perspective. That was Sir Rony Montoho Fahilagutan. Are we good, sir?
Yeah.
Okay. So on this note, ladies and gentlemen, we are still having our Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines Continuing Education Program. Now, to show our appreciation to our fourth speaker for today, let's all together show our spirit fingers to Sir Rony. Yay, there you go. Thank you very much for your active participation. So on this note, I know that you are still formulating your questions in store for our speakers. Don't you worry, we will be entertaining them a little later during our open forum. Meantime, ladies and gentlemen, as we gear on to the second half of our continuing education program for this afternoon, we have one company which will be doing their product demonstration. On this queue, ladies and gentlemen, please direct your eyes to our screen, to your screens in front of you, as we all together have our first company to have their product demo.
Every day, Cardinal Health Protexis surgical gloves protect the hands that heal. We've become an industry-leading producer of surgical gloves thanks to unparalleled quality control and a culture of excellence that's endured for more than 50 years. Let's take a closer look at how we build trust into every glove we make. It all begins here in our production center in Rayong, Thailand. This is where the industry's most experienced professionals combine chemistry, mechanical engineering, and Lean Six Sigma processes to create more than 1 million pairs of gloves each day. Our patented formulations are engineered specifically for use with our proprietary ergonomic glove molds. Our statistical process controls monitor nearly 2,000 variables in the manufacturing process, providing critical insights, trends, and opportunities that further enhance production efficiency. In total, more than 150 technicians oversee our quality assurance system. Their expertise ensures a consistent, high-quality product that surgeons rely on around the world. We know you can't outsource trust, so we control every aspect of the Protexis supply chain, from research and development to manufacturing and distribution. And yet, even more important to our legacy of success is our people. Everyone at Cardinal Health understands that Protexis gloves are where healthcare literally touches lives. You see it in their decades of loyal service, their attention to detail, their commitment to the highest industry standards, and in their desire to seek new and innovative ways to deliver the best gloves possible. Our goal is absolute product consistency and on-time shipments, and we're very proud of the results. An over 99% certainty of supply, a level of reliability that you can trust. Because we know you depend on these gloves when your patients are relying on you the most. Cardinal Health Protexis Surgical Gloves, the perfect fit for the hands that heal.
Medevac, a global leader in fluid management. The Medevac flexible liner system delivers exceptional performance with a suite of built-in safety features. The system includes reusable outer canisters, mounting hardware, and single-use flexible liners. Each flexible liner lid includes a patient port, vacuum port, accessory port, and tandem port. In addition, Medevac flexible liner lids contain built-in safety features such as an automatic shutoff valve, bacterial filter, and one-way valve designed to prevent backflow. Liners are permanently attached to the lids, so no assembly is required. Their compact and lightweight design helps to minimize storage space requirements. With a variety of sizes and configurations, Medevac flexible liners meet the unique needs of various procedures. They can be used standalone or in tandem for large volume cases. Please contact your Cardinal Health sales representative or visit us online at cardinalhealth.com. The cutting edge of safety. Speed. And simplicity. In preoperative hair removal. Introducing the new Cardinal Health Surgical Clipper. The innovative design includes features that improve both patient and staff safety. The fixed lower blade provides a safe zone at the point of contact by keeping the cutting action away from the skin. The smart design brings simplicity to the preoperative hair removal process. The clipper handle attaches effortlessly to the disposable blades. The standard prep blade can be used for most procedures. The optional specialty blade can be used for neurosurgery and very coarse hair. Additional features that make the clippers easy to use include a touch-free attach and release blade system, the drop-and-go charging station, a battery indicator light, color-coded blades and packaging, and the device is simple to clean with a germicidal wipe. Designed to improve safety, speed, and simplicity, the Cardinal Health Surgical Clipper takes preoperative hair removal to the cutting edge. To learn more, contact your Cardinal Health sales representative. Thank you.
There you go. That was our first company to demonstrate their products to our dear nurses and participants. Please do not forget to support the products of Cardinal Health. So after getting to hear our four speakers for this afternoon, we'll now be proceeding with the second half, which is our open forum. By the way, for everyone's information and guidance, our organizers have already picked set questions coming from our participants in order for us to facilitate a spontaneous flow. So if you happen to have any more questions to raise, please don't hesitate to raise it in our chat box. By the way, I have been blabbering all afternoon, but I haven't introduced myself yet. I am Alphon Guillier D. Daga. I am the current endoscopy unit head nurse of the Eastern Visayas Regional Medical Center and at the same time the current governor of the Philippine Nurses Association Region 8. I think that our OR head nurse is currently attending Hi Ma'am Belen Limos and our ORNAP Leyte chapter as well, President Ma'am Meneses. Good afternoon. So without much ado, let's proceed with our first set of picked questions for our speakers. I believe that our first set of questions is directed to our first speaker that we had for this afternoon. That was Dr. Benjamin Valera. Is Dr. Valera still here, Doc?
Yeah, I'm here. Can you?
All right, there you go.
The first question.
Yes, I believe, Doc, that the first question raised for you is how can the anesthesiologist support the less contact time exposure of the surgical team in terms of anesthesia administration? Would it be okay for me to finish all three questions first? All right, so our second question is, are there any recommendation from the society to prevent anesthesiologists as a carrier of the disease, thus exposing the team to such diseases? And the third question directed to Dr. Valera is, during procedure with a positive COVID-19 patient, what should the team need to know in anesthesiologist's perspective? So Doc, the floor is yours. Dr. Valera?
Okay, I was unmuted. Okay, how can the anesthesiologist support the less contact time exposure of the surgical team in terms of anesthesia administration? Can I ask you a supporting question? When you say the less contact time exposure of the surgical team, what do you actually mean?
I think, Doc, on my own understanding, this less contact time exposure will be during the intraoperative or I guess the contact with the patient. I don't, this is just how I understand the question.
The way I understood this question is when we conduct anesthesia, we will ask the personnel, the surgical staff, and the other nurses, except for maybe for my assistant and maybe a single nurse, to help me during induction, especially if the patient is in to undergo a general anesthetic. Okay, but before that, I would really ask that we have a simulation because I noticed that in all the operating rooms I go to, whenever a patient is wheeled inside the operating room, a lot of the people don't know their respective roles. Number one, who's going to put in the monitors? Number two, who's going to prepare the medicine? No? Number three, who's going to roll out that operating room bed? And number four, who's supposed to carry the patient. So a lot of times, what I notice is the delay from rolling in to the actual induction takes time. I would like an ideal setup, just like in a Formula One race. If you'll notice, in a Formula One car racing, every time there's a pit stop, there's a team that have their own, with members that have their own roles in such a way that in a span of maybe less than 20 seconds, they were able to refuel, they were able to change the tires of the car, and they were able to tune up the car. Now, that's in a span of 20 seconds. I really hope that in the Philippines, we can do that. No, if we only have respective roles attended to, identify the roles. Number one, we identify the roles of each team member. And number two, not only the roles, we should also have a simulation prior to putting that patient inside the operating room. So how can the anesthesiologist support the less contact time exposure of the surgical team? Maybe if we have a better teamwork, no? So that the placement of the monitors, the wheeling in of the patient is much more organized, anesthesia can be induced much faster. Number two, the question is, are there any recommendations from the society to prevent an anesthesiologist at such area of the disease, thus exposing the team to such disease? Now, this is a question which is supposed to protect the other healthcare workers and the patient from the disease of the anesthesiologist. So if the anesthesiologist is an infectious disease carrier, as much as possible, the recommendation is the anesthesiologist will not give anesthesia. But if it so happens that a lot of times we really do not know that we are sick or not, we are asymptomatic carriers, the recommendation now in this pandemic is we still wear the PPEs from head to toe, don the PPEs properly and doff it properly, not only to protect yourself, but also to protect the patient and to protect the other healthcare workers as well. And number three, during the procedure with the COVID-19 patient, what should the team need to know in the anesthesiologist perspective? So I'm going to conduct the patient under general anesthesia. I would like to have a video laryngoscope. Maybe I would like to have an aerosol box, or better still, the intubating drapes. I would like to have a suction apparatus, an inline suction apparatus. And I would like to have a nurse that would anticipate my every movement that I need. Now, if I have to suction, the nurse will have to give me the suction, and I don't have to tell her to give me the suction. So if you will notice, a good clinical eye in terms of the nurse or my assistant would really, really be very, very important. And that's it.
Wow, thank you very much, Dr. Valera. And point of clarification as well, Doctor, for the question number one, yes, we're the organizers and you were both on the same page. For clarification of the question, that meant less exposure, process, and contact time of the patient. And yes, Doc, I couldn't agree with you more when you said that protection is really the name of the game. It should really be upfront and it should be a priority. Thank you very much, Dr. Valera. If you happen to have any more questions related to the discussion of Dr. Valera, please go ahead and comment down below on our chat box. Okay? So meantime, Dr. Valera, as we await for further questions for you, let's make use of our time and proceed with our second speaker as we go ahead and raise the questions directed for her. We have Dr. Esther Sagil. Hi, Dr. Sagil. Good afternoon.
Yeah, can you hear me?
Thank you very much, Doc. Yes, Doc. Alam mo, Doc, we were very much in relate. We're very much relate na relate talaga, Doc, with your discussion, because I think that that is really that your discussion applies across the board. So, Doc, we have a set of questions that was gathered for you. These are the questions. Let me read the questions 1 to 4 first. The first question raised was, if the patient PCR test is negative within 5 days, will the PPE can be downgraded to level 3 or 2? Wow. Second question is there a specific time to perform a surgical procedure after negative result of PCR test? The third question for you, Doc, is for some hospitals, due to limited resources, no smoke evacuator is available in the PUI or COVID positive room. What are the alternatives to protect the team? And finally, question number four, during procedure with a COVID positive patient, what should the team need to know in surgeon's perspective? Doc?
Okay, thank you. Thank you for your questions. For number one, regarding a negative PCR, as I emphasized earlier on during the lecture, a negative PCR does not mean that the patient does not have coronavirus. It may mean that the patient is pre-symptomatic or asymptomatic carrier. No, na hindi pa lang siya na-detect. So what PPE can you use? I would strongly suggest that at least a PPE 3 minimum. Okay? I would not, if you're in a surgical field, in the surgical, as a part of a surgical team, I would not want you to be in PPE level 2 only. Okay? So, but I think we have to be on the same page as to what 3 and 2 are. So 3 is with face shield, with goggles, N95 mask. Definitely at least an N95 mask, or in the Philippines and in China, it's KN95. No, pwede na yon. No, but definitely at this time, I would not be encouraging everybody to be in the operating room with just a plain surgical mask. That's for sure. So I think the long and short of that answer for this question is, kahit na negative yung PCR test niya, if the patient comes from a place where there is community, massive community transmission like NCR, best be prepared. Number two, the specific time to perform a surgical procedure after a negative PCR test. Again, same answer. We have the evidence, we have the tables, we have the graphs. But still, in the implementation, the devil is always in the details. Okay? Laging yung implementation tayo nakakatanong. Iba-iba ang mga hospitals implementation. And you know what I noticed? I think a lot of it is based on experience. There are hospitals here in the NCR which had a really bad experience with COVID. No, na meron silang staff na anesthesiologist, even surgeons who succumbed. And that puts them in a more, we understand the fear going on. That sometimes over and above yung ginagawa nila na preparation. We all know about telemed, but you know, ngayon, di ba, pre-scheduled na ang mga clinics, hindi na pwedeng walk-in sa clinic. Lalo na sa operations, you do not schedule them without a PCR test. The magic number now is 7 days. Many hospitals accept an RT-PCR result as long as the date of when it was done is within 7 days of the surgery. But if you have the graph, no, you saw the post of Dr. Salvania, it doesn't really mean anything. If we're operating on an asymptomatic, no symptom patient, there is still the remote possibility that that patient is just pre-symptomatic. Kaya yung kanyang RT-PCR is still negative. Okay? So walang kasiguraduhan. And that is why there are a lot of journal articles coming out now regarding an informed consent specific for the COVID pandemic. Hindi na yata pwede yung dati nating consent. I consent to Dr. Sagil doing the procedure for me. And I understand the risk procedure. Ngayon, inapa-itemize na sa amin. Itemize mo na even if RT-PCR is done, there is still a 20% chance that your patient has COVID, given that you live in an ECQ in a high transmission area. So there's no specific time. Now, what is important is we have surveillance, we have workup. I even saw an anesthesiologist who was asking for a CT scan for a ruptured appendicitis. CT scan of the chest, ha? For a ruptured appendicitis patient kasi hindi daw wala daw resulta ng RT-PCR, emergency surgery. So, ano yun? E normal yung chest x-ray. It gets really funny. When you're scared, you tend to be irrational. When actually the rational thing to do here is be prepared, be ready. If we don't know the status, the RT-PCR or the COVID status of the patient, act, proceed like the patient is COVID positive. Yes, it is going to be more expensive, but you might end up if you end up also, no, what's the price to pay? So mag-COVID na lang tayo, mag-COVID positive mindset na lang tayo. But at the same time, the patient should also be aware. Kasi there was already a case in the US na nagsusue siya kasi nagkaroon siya ng COVID after. But then they were able to prove that the exposure came from outside. For number three, for some hospitals with resources, so the smoke evacuator, okay. I said something about the smoke evacuator. You can modify. You can modify, you can, if you have your cautery machine and you have a submachine, just put the cautery inside, not just distal, mga last 2 centimeters, ipapagod yung doon cautery machine, yung cautery tip, no? And that will already help evacuate the smoke coming out. Regarding pa ng RT-PCR, this is another problem. So in Manila kasi, although madami na tayong mga laboratorio na gumagawa ng RT-PCR, the results come out variable, no? Variably. We have yung mga mahal na sometimes as much as 12,000 pesos, they can give the results within 48 hours. Ang totoo, the test can be done in the 3 to 6 hours. But of course, there's validation, there's volume, there's documentation, kaya tumatagal. But there are still areas here in the Philippines, particularly in the provinces, yung hindi urban site, na wala naman silang RT-PCR. And I know that the fear is there. But thankfully, also in those areas, hindi rin naman grabe yung community transmission pa. So a lot of the worries and a lot of the preparations that you do is also dependent on the degree of community transmission. Dahan-dahan nagkakaroon na eh. Nagkakaroon na sa Oriental Mindoro, kaya ayaw nila magpapasok. No? Don't accept antibody testing. That's useless. It just tells you whether you got infected, but if it's negative, wala siya. Okay? It doesn't tell you anything about infectivity. And number four, during a procedure with positive COVID-19 patient, what should the team know? I will second Dr. Valera. We have to be prepared. You have to be even before the huddle, napag-isipan. Di ba matagal naman yung in-between cases? Pero alam natin na COVID-19 yung susunod na kaso. We should all be informed, no? I think most ORs now have a dedicated COVID operating room, and it's usually the operating room nearest the entrance ng complex para pasok siya agad. Wala na siya masyadong i-contaminate pa. Okay. If you know that you're going to be working with a COVID-positive patient, unang-una, PPEs. Number two, preparation mo. Prepare the patient. Prepare the gamut. You know that it's a cholecystectomy. Know all the gamut of cholecystectomy, all the sutures required. No? Pati sa anesthesia, all the sizes, lahat ng sizes ng ET, hindi yung isang endotracheal tube lang, lalabas na naman ulit para kumuha ng panibagong endotracheal tube. Ayaw natin ng ganun. We want to minimize moving, opening, closing doors, and spreading the virus. Okay? And then, I alluded earlier to communication. It's very hard to communicate inside an operating room where everybody is in elastomeric masks or N95 masks. No, bulol and ngongo tayo lahat. Everything is hollow. So you have to speak a little louder. And if you speak a little louder, you spend more energy and you end up being breathless in a while. And not everybody is in a good operating room with magandang air conditioning system and exhaust. If you notice, ang init kahit anong gawin mo pag nakagoggles ka, basang-basa ang mukha mo. We're all drenched to the skin after a 1 hour operation. So this adds up to the discomfort, pagod, and additive yung effect niya and the fear pa. No? So that's why we try to lessen the fear by doing the schedules of 7 days on 7 days of makapahinga man lang yung utak mo kung hindi yung katawan. And then of course, we ask everybody to pray all the time before and after surgeries because I think nakakalimutan din yata natin na prayers really will work wonders for everybody, di ba? So, I think I've answered your questions unless there are any more.
Thank you very much, Dr. Sagil. And I really agree with you, Doc, especially that prayers should really come before anything else because I believe that whatever PPE or no matter how good the quality of our PPEs are, if we forget to pray, then the guidance of our Almighty, without the guidance of our Almighty, it would defeat the purpose of everything. Thank you very much, Doctora. We are still waiting for a couple more questions to be raised for you, okay? Meantime, ladies and gentlemen, after getting to hear the answers coming from our first two speakers, let's go ahead and get to know another company to have their product demonstration. On this queue, fellow nurses, please direct your eyes to our to your screens that you see in front of you as we welcome another company. Enjoy. Once again, a gentle reminder to all our participants to please have your microphones muted, not unless you are acknowledged to speak. As we gear on for our second company to do their product demonstration, once again, we are still having our Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines continuing education program. On this queue, ladies and gents, let's queue in our second company to do their product demonstration. And I believe that we are still having some technical difficulties regarding playing the product demonstration video of our second company. So I guess it's safe to proceed with our third series of sessions directed to our third speaker. We already had a lot of discussions that went on. We started early, and at the same time, we already got to hear all our four speakers. So meantime, let's go ahead and unveil our questions directed to our third speaker. We would like to call in Dr. Ray Gapos Jr.
Thank you very much.
Dr. Ray had a very... Hi, Doc. Thank you very much for inspiring us all. You know what? That song was really moving. I myself was also singing.
Thank you. You have
I'm here
everyone will have
singing.
A copy of that like empowerment toolbox. I created a video of a because we can just talk about these things. It's nice if we have activity-based interactions, and I have that on video. So it's going to be sent to everyone so that even beyond this, if they want to practice it, they can choose from any of those empowerment strategies I mentioned in that specific video. So to address the first question, explain the factors affecting coping skills of healthcare professionals during a time of crisis. If we're going to take a look at the top five common stressors of adults, individuals, whether we're having crisis or not, whether we're having pandemic or not, you would notice that these five common stressors are possibly, okay, it could actually occur one after the other at this time of the pandemic. Example, number one would be death of a loved one. Second would be divorce. Third, loss of a job. Third, a fourth, increased financial obligations. And fifth, marriage. Now, whenever you are exposed to any of these stressors, there's a study that says that you increase your risk of dying due to stress by 30%, okay, for each of these stressors. Such that if you're going to take a look at the top five common stressors of adults, how would you decrease it? Would you rather remain unmarried during the pandemic just to decrease your stress-related risk of dying by 30%? Now, there's already a survey that's being done in China among healthcare workers. And an interesting finding in that survey is that some of the healthcare workers who actually tried to hold on to their jobs while their husbands lost theirs are thinking about filing for divorce as one of the first few things they want to do after the pandemic. So you can just imagine how much strain has the pandemic place on the married life of healthcare workers. Eh kung dagdagan pa nang may namatay, I mean, you lose a friend, you lose a family. So, the more na mas madami. Now, another important thing that we have to take a look at this point in time would be we are placing ourselves in an environment in which it's difficult to thrive because the working conditions are not that ideal. And at the same time, the risk may always outweigh whatever advantages that we would want to think about our noble profession. So at this point in time, the focus should really be self-compassion, meaning compassion directed inward such that we are able to cope with the common stressors. So parang tinasabi natin sa Tagalog, maawa muna tayo sa sarili natin. Otherwise, when we get exposed to traumatic situations like the death of a loved one, the death of a friend, the death of a family member, vicarious traumatization occurs. So vicarious traumatization is different from secondary traumatic stress, because in secondary traumatic stress, this could occur abruptly. Meaning to say, if you got exposed to somebody close to you who died today, you get secondary traumatic stress. But if this happens frequently, such that the stress that you're experiencing would produce a cumulative effect on your body, then we have vicarious traumatization. And eventually, that could potentially lead to compassion fatigue syndrome. When you say compassion fatigue syndrome, naubos na po yung ability natin to provide care, because compassion, one of the core values that define our caring attitude, is already compromised. So, how do we deal with these factors? First and foremost, we have to first think of ourselves. Just like what the popular song says, learning to love yourself is the greatest love of all. We really cannot give what we don't have. So at this point in time, hindi naman siguro pagkamadamot na ang una muna natin tignan, paano ba tayo, yung sarili natin. And there are nice things or personal empowerment strategies that we could implement. Number two, identify at least two personal empowerment strategies that they can adopt in their everyday routine. I'd share more than two. First, you have to maintain work-life balance at this point. Now, how do you go about work-life balance? Okay, basic. If you can keep two separate cellular phones, one would just have your family and friends, the second would be work phone, or if you can't afford to have that, just buy two SIM cards and buy a phone with dual SIM. Then what do? The moment you step out of your work environment, you turn off your work phone. Do not make your house an extension of your working environment, because if you're going to do that, okay, you are actually depleting your energy. And we have to acknowledge the fact that man's energy is not limitless. Meron tayong limit. And because of this, we commit mistakes sometimes because we are already just too tired or too fatigued to even think about what we're doing. So this is where we have to take care first of ourselves. Okay, otherwise, if we do that, sabihin mo, passionate tayo about what we're doing. The passion eventually turns into compassion fatigue syndrome. And what defines compassion fatigue syndrome? There are three things. Actually, we can use the metaphor of a person with compassion fatigue syndrome is as cold as ice, I-C-E. First, the person who's having compassion fatigue syndrome would experience a lot of inadequacies, okay? So they feel that they are inadequate physically, inadequate emotionally. Second, C, they become cynical. Now, a cynic is somebody who doubts even their own abilities. So nawawala yung tiwala, nawawala yung confidence level sa sarili. And third, E, I-C-E, exhaustion. Okay? So naubos na emosyon, naubos na enerhiya. At the end of the day, the question now is, pag tayo bilang nurse na ubos yung ating capability to provide care, who would replenish that for us? So at the end of the day, we realize that walang ibang gagawa nun for us but ourselves. So rather than pushing ourselves beyond the limits of what we can really do, it's nice to have like 10 minutes me time every day. What does a me time require us to do? One, you just have 10 minutes being alone. Learn how to say no. Tell your coworkers not to distract you. Okay? Do something that you want to do within those 10 minutes. Okay? Some of us may want to have like, they have like small plants. They start watering the plants, rearranging pebbles around the plants. That is very therapeutic. Those of you who love to have pets, there are studies that actually have proven that, you know, stroking a pet or combing a pet would actually help in the release of oxytocin, which increases our ability to empathize. So in other words, if we take a look at stress as something positive, stress could increase the secretion of oxytocin, and oxytocin increases our need for bonding socially. So it enhances our human connection. And with that, when we are able to increase our human connection, we are able to replenish whatever motivations or whatever the things that we've lost because of exhaustion. And so in essence, we will be able to motivate ourselves better to work harder. Okay. Another strategy I'd like to share with you is that sometimes because of fatigue, napagod na tayo, natulog na tayo, kinabukasan, we drag our feet. Kasi naubos na yung inerya natin. We're sweating out because of the PPEs, tapos ang daming cases, ang daming worries. Okay. So what can we do? Okay. So that you can motivate yourself to maintain high level of energy the moment you start your work. Mag-prepare ka ng tinatawag nating anticipated package. Wow, di ba nung bata tayo, when Christmas season comes in, kahit alam naman natin, magulang natin naglalagay doon sa ating mga sinasabit na socks. Okay. Meron pa rin tayong anticipation na ano kaya makukuha ko. So you do that to yourself. Okay? Nobody would do that to you right now. You have to do it to yourself. Okay? You have to learn how to do it to yourself. So how do you go about this? Well, prepare your favorite food or your favorite snack, favorite chocolates before sleeping at night so that subconsciously when you wake up in the morning, you will be greeted by something that you like. So meron kang kakaining tsokolate, meron kang kakaining pagkain. Sabi nung isang mini-mentor ko about self-empowerment. Sabi niya, sir, ginawa ko yung suggestion mo. O anong effect? Sabi niya, very positive, sir. Ano ibig sabihin na positive? Positive, sir, na nag-gain ako ng weight. Okay. Bakit nag-gain ka ng weight? Sabi niya, kasi di ba, sir, sabi mo, prepare ko yung food na favorite ko. De, prepare ko. And then, natulog po ako. Okay. Pagkatapos, gumising po ako ng maaga, excited po ako, kinain ko po yung pagkain. Then after that, sabi niya, natulog po uli ako. Okay. So, hindi natin kailangan gawin yon. But what I'm trying to say is that let's keep the excitement about waking up in the morning because some of us would feel like every day nagigising ka, nawawalan ka ng gana because ang thinking mo, ipapasok na naman ako sa aking work, mapapagod na naman ako. Okay? So you always have to have some rewards for yourself at the end of the day. Okay? And talking about what are some of the things that we can do after work that will help us replenish our energy. Well, there's a study done and published in Harvard. It's actually an observational study that says people who regularly take tub baths, meaning twice, thrice, or even every day, they have warm water tub bath every day after work, will have 28% less incidence of cardiovascular disease and 26% less incidence of stroke. Therefore, ang tanong, paano sir pag wala kaming bathtub? Okay. Baka naman pwedeng batya na lang lagyan natin. Sir, ano bang importante doon? Is it the warmth of the water or is it the position of the person having a tub bath? Actually, both. Because we can always take a bath with warm water, but when you are relaxing your body with the buoyant force of water as if you are floating, and then you have warmth all over your body. So it helps your muscles to relax. Okay. So those are personal empowerment strategies. Once again, a complete version of all these things outlined in the acronym POWER is contained in the pre-recorded video that I did for everyone because I know for a fact that we are under time constraints. So I took it upon myself to create that. And let's go over question number 3. Describe the 4 basic steps of personal empowerment. Okay. Before we even talk about personal empowerment begins with self-compassion. And if we talk of self-compassion, there are 3 elements. The first one would be self-kindness. So if we're not kind enough to ourselves, who would be kind to us?
Okay. Second would be the principle of common humanity. We always say, tao lang po. Okay? Ito yung, pag nagkamali tayo, we say, tao lang po. So don't ever, ever forget that. It's the principle of common humanity. Acknowledgement that no one is perfect. Kaya nga meron akong estudyante. Sabi ko, which among these three elements of self-compassion do you live in your everyday life? Sabi niya, sir, yung element number two. Okay? Common humanity. So how do you live it? Sabi niya, I adopted a mantra. And I said, what's your mantra? Kasi ganito lang yan, sir. Students go to school to become perfect at what they do. However, nobody is perfect. So, why go to school? Okay. So, yun yung kanyang perspective. Ang tinatawag nating acknowledgement that you can just be everyone else. No one is perfect. Okay? So, we all have imperfections. So, it's all right to have imperfections. For as long as we learn from the mistakes that we usually incur because of our imperfections. And the third element of self-compassion is mindfulness. Living in the present. And you can do this during your me-time sessions every day. Okay. Now, having these elements now would enable you to go through the four basic steps of personal empowerment. What's the first thing that you have to do? Every day, you set a goal. Simple goal. Something that's achievable. Like staying healthy and surviving the day's activities. It's a very simple goal. But the moment you achieve it, you feel elated. So after goal setting, then you need to develop the skills to address the goals. So what do you need to do? You organize yourself, keep track of your activities, stay on track, and keep your focus. And then after that, make positive choices. Now, always choose to be positive. And how do you go about being positive? Always choosing to first love yourself at this point in time. That's not selfishness. You have to love yourself so that you will be capable of loving others. And last but not the least is to take action, which simply means you have to build on the successes that you've achieved on a daily basis so that you can maximize your capacity. So with this, I hope I am able to share with you some important concepts about personal empowerment strategies. Once again, these are carefully outlined on my pre-recorded videotape talk that's going to be sent to you through a YouTube channel. So the link will be sent out on Monday. Okay, so if you have questions, please feel free to ask me at any point in time. Okay, salamat po.
Wow, thank you very much, Dr. Gapos. I really like the me time, Doc, you know, the 10 minutes that you will be devoting for yourself. You can do whatever you want. Within 10 minutes, it would give you peace of mind. And at the same time, it would allow you to focus more on what you are doing. Because, Doc, always remember that getting to love yourself is the greatest love of all. Oh.
And to
thank you very much.
Yeah, to add on the 10 minutes me time, you could actually, it's not a fault or a sin to use your gadgets during your 10 minutes me time. You can use that to talk to your relatives, to talk to a friend, to talk to the boyfriend, the suitor, the girlfriend. You can do anything with it because that's now the trend. In fact, even in education, students are allowed technology breaks. Because if you don't allow them to, we don't address the intrinsic motivation of staying connected. And as social beings, we need that at this point in time. So, sana, no, yung ating mga managers sa OR, i-allow nyo yung 10 minutes me time, technology break ng OR nurses, where they can just, you know, be with themselves and commune with themselves.
Exactly, Doc. For the mindfulness and at the same time, for the mental well-being of our nurses. So thank you very much, Dr. Gapos. Thank you very much for addressing those three questions directed to you. Meantime, let's go ahead and proceed with our fourth speaker that we listened to earlier on this afternoon. I believe that our fourth speaker will be dealing with the questions directed to the experiences of OR nurse managers. So can we please welcome once again Sir Ronan Steve. Gentle reminder, please cover participants. Have your microphones on mute. Once again, a gentle reminder, please, to our participants to please have your microphones on mute as our speakers are still trying to address the questions. Meantime, ladies and gents, let's welcome once again our fourth speaker that we listened to earlier this afternoon. We have Sir Ronnie Montoho Fahilagutan. Sir Ronnie, are you there?
Yeah.
Yes. Okay, sir. So we have three questions directed for you as well. The first question is, can you share the best practices that must be employed in the staffing pattern of the nurses considering the personnel for COVID and non-COVID operating rooms? Second is it recommended to pull out the ward to the OR and vice versa? And how can you prevent nurses from absenteeism? Wow, a very common problem nowadays, or AWOL. And the third is, during procedures with a positive COVID-19 patient, what should the team need to know in nurse manager perspective, sir?
Okay, thank you for that question. I would like to address first on the first question. First of all, since we are dealing with this extraordinary time, there must be a clear guideline in the staffing pattern. Now, as I have said a while ago, that in the first phase of this pandemic, the nursing personnel in the OR was divided into three teams, A, B, and C, who reported 7 days work and 14 days off. Then it was reduced to 5 days to 10 days. And upon resumption of the GCQ and several services in the hospital, it boils down to 7 days to 7 days duty and 7 days off. And this is in the COVID ward, but for the non-COVID, it is back to the regular days. And also some factors to consider also, no? We have the age of the perioperative nurse. When you are senior citizens already, you are not already are not assigned to the COVID wards. And also if you have comorbidity, you are not been assigned to the COVID ward. And for the second question, is it recommended to pull out the ward nurses to the OR and vice versa? And how can you prevent nurses from absenteeism and AWOL? In our case, in PGH, the operating room complex sends staff, no, to the COVID wards to augment their staffing, no. So this staff report in the COVID ward. It takes turns, no? So hindi lang sila nang sila ang nandoon. Like for instance, in the first phase of the ECQ, there are 16, no? And then ngayon, 8 na lang sila na nagkon kasi nag-open na ang aming operating room. And as far as I know, there is only one instance na that a COVID nurse needed na i-pull out sa other areas, but not sa ward, no? So nag-pull out ang Division of Clinical Nursing Operation ng isang nurse sa obstetric admitting section kasi nag-o-opera din sila doon. So it must, kasi ang aming kaso ay gyne case, so na-pull out siya kasi ang isang nurse namin ay cannot report for some reason. So pag sa ward, hindi kami nagpo-pull out kasi tuturuan mo pa siya. So alam mo naman sa operating room kailangan yung precision and efficient na nurse, especially during this time. And it is important also that during the reassignment of nursing personnel in this time would be planned well. Like for instance, usually the OR complex sends nursing personnel to various COVID wards, and it must be clear to the staff and the staff schedule that this staff or OR nurse will be reporting to a particular COVID ward. Hindi na lang yung basta-basta pinupull out mo. So halimbawa, sa 1 to 15, so last month dapat sinabihan mo na siya, so that he can prepare physically, emotionally, spiritually, and more importantly, psychologically. So dapat prepared sila doon, hindi lang pinupull out ng basta-basta. And there are also times when a nurse in the COVID OR was pulled out to the COVID ward, no? Pero nagre-reklamo sila. So ang ginawa sa COVID OR, nagde-deck na lang, no? Also in the non-COVID ward and non-COVID OR. So dinideck nila kung sino ang mapupull out in times of exigency. Kasi sasama talaga ang loob nila when they are not prepared. So the OR complex makes decking to the nurses in both ORs who to pull out during the time of exigency. And one thing more, to boost the morale of the nursing staff is to make sure that PPE is complete, no? When they perform perioperative nursing function in the COVID OR. And also they were provided with accommodation and transportation. And the PJHOR complex is doing celebration victories or when the staff nurse is celebrating birthday, no? So nagsi-celebrate sa OR. And also, in my recollection, there are just nag-i-enjoy naman ang mga kahit na mahirap, nag-i-enjoy naman sila when they are rotated sa mga COVID wards, no? And meron lang kaming isang, I think, nursing personnel na hindi na nag-report. Isa lang yon. So, hindi na nag-report kasi nagkaroon siya ng panic attack. So, pero, ano to? So, yung staffing pattern ay ginawa na ng trinano na ng maigi ng OR complex. And to answer the third question, during the procedure with COVID positive patient, what should the team needs to know? No, in PGH perioperative setting, after declaring that PGH become the COVID-19 referral hospital for the NCR, the operating room management team has convened right away to plan on how to go about this pandemic. And the OR, the ORMAT has crafted COVID OR processes and policies to guide the team during the performance of every surgical procedure, which is being used during orientation of the members of the surgical team, which includes structural zoning of the COVID OR complex, preoperative preparation, patient transportation, patient record handling of patient personal effects, no? And all our personnel attend to this orientation and demonstration of PPE. While we are doing the initial orientation or the demonstration of the PPE on the correct doffing and donning procedure, psychosocial debriefing and briefing also was conducted. This is care of the PGH Care Society.
Yan. Sige.
Engagement COVID ward before yan. Engagement to COVID OR or ward.
Okay.
And the Department of Surgery has also developed or created a video on PPE. Kasi ang sa Dinet, ang ginagawa lang namin is yung donning na pang ward. So ang donning and doffing sa operating room is different from the doffing and donning and doffing sa the ward. So they created a video to guide the members of the surgical team. Also, the Department of Anesthesiology also made a video on how to prepare the aerosol box, on how to prepare the MacBrat endolaryngoscope, and how to decontaminate this after usage. And the members of the surgical team is doing huddle also 30 minutes before surgery. This is to discuss the pre, the intra-op, and the post-operative needs of the patient. And they also discuss the possible situation that might happen, the possible instruments and supplies that they are going to utilize during the surgery. And this will guide, sa huddle, meron silang ginagamit na checklist, like for this one. So may mga usually ang this activity is being initiated or led by the circulating nurse or the OR runner. So actually ang members ng surgical team sa COVID OR are circulating nurse, the OR runner. Itong OR runner, hindi ito siya pumapasok sa OR per se. Doon lang siya sa may orange zone, no? And then the scrub nurse, the utility worker, and of course the surgeon, the anesthesiologist, and the utility workers inside the operating room. So during HADL, dito ini-emphasize on re-review yung kanilang mga role, no? Sabi nga kanina ni Dr. Sagil na they should know their roles, no? And after the briefing also, after the surgery, they also conduct a debriefing session to identify the gaps in the systems and processes, identify areas of improvement in patient and occupational safety. And it is also in this session where surgical team members suggest an action plan and evaluate team performance. And sabi nga kanina ni Dr. Valera that the surgical team must do simulation. So they do that. They simulate surgery prior to the surgery proper. And the OR complex also have fabricated an ante room just before, doon nila linalagay yon sa entrance mismo ng operating room per se. So this is movable. Once the patient, the members of the surgical team goes in the operating room, nilalagay na nila doon yung ante room. Itong ante room na to was created where, kung halimbawa manganganak, the bassinet for the baby is placed and a table is also placed in order for the OR runner to drop the needed sterile instrument or supply na hindi na i-prepare. So yung runner siya yung kumukuha sa supply room, sa pharmacy ng mga needed items sa surgery. So they are also provided with walkie-talkie, no? Walkie-talkie para sa circulating nurse at anesthesiologist or yung surgeon nagre-relay lang ng messages through walkie-talkie. And the OR runner, siya yung kumukuha ng kailangan nila and they drop it sa ante room. And a safety officer is designated to ensure and guide the members of the surgical team during the donning and doffing procedure using a checklist also. They have also a checklist. Ito. They have a checklist also and this will make the members of the surgical team assured that they will be protected from being contracted by the virus, especially during doffing procedure, which is very crucial. And the nursing personnel also are tasked to cover all the equipment in the OR with the plastic cling wraps, no? So not to be contaminated with the virus. And the nursing personnel also takes charge the aftercare of the OR, leaving all equipment first, instruments soak in a disinfectant solution and pack the garbage in the OR for an hour for UV light exposure, no? So hindi nila yun nilalabas. Okay? And then this pandemic also is a reality. It's already a reality in our life. Whether we like it or not, it has become part of our life. And may it be personal and professional. So yun lang po. I hope that I answered your question.
Thank you very much, Sir Ronnie. I believe that all your inputs will be very beneficial to all of our nurses who are currently in attendance with our continuing education program. So I believe that at this point, we're on with our second company to do their product demonstration. So with that being said, ladies and gentlemen, fellow nurses, please direct your eyes to your screens that you see in front of you as we welcome our second company for their product. Thank you very much for that product demonstration. Do we have any more questions to be raised? Mm-hmm. Hello? All right, so I believe that we have now come to the final point of our continuing education program, which is the closing remarks. On this cue, ladies and gentlemen, we would like to hear some closing words coming from the Vice President of our perioperative, Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines.
Congratulations, Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines, also known as ORNAP, in partnership with Dr. Ray Gapus Jr. for this successful webinar, first time. And then thank you also to ORNAP Board of Directors, headed by Dr. Gabriel Naig. Also to our past presidents of ORNAP, chapters in different regions, members, and other viewers, for making this possible. Thank you, panelists, Dr. Esther Sagil, Dr. Benjamin Valera, Dr. Ray Gapus, Dr. Bridget Launarin, Sir Ronnie Fahilahutan for sharing this knowledge, their knowledge and experiences, and salamat po for enlightening us. Thank you also to our partners and exhibitors, LifeLink Incorporated and Medtronic for their great presentations and all for always helping us and show their workmanship and innovations. Thank you to our moderator, Mr. Alfundaga, for gracing the show and made this event a fruitful and intelligent discussions. And of course, most of all, thank you to our Lord Jesus Christ for giving us the courage to fulfill what message you would like us to realize. We will always remember that what is happening right now is not just merely negative, but it also has a positive impact in our lives, especially love of nature, bayanihan, and now we have time to our family, and most especially calling God not just for help, but also for thanking Him for giving us time to reflect. Amen. Amen. God be with us all. Thank you.
Thank you very much to all our participants. We hope that you'll be able to put all our learnings to good use. Mad props as well to all our discussants, our panelists for this afternoon, Dr. Benjamin Valera, Dr. Esther Sagil. We also had Dr. Ray Gapos Jr. and Sir Ronnie Montoho Fahilagutan. We also want to give our warmest congratulations to ORNAP Philippines, headed by our President, President Gabriel Naig. On this queue, ladies and gentlemen, this has been your host and facilitator for this afternoon. My name is Alfon. This has been the Perioperative Registered Nurses Association of the Philippines Continuing Education Program.